having me back this evening. It's very nice to be back in person. I think this is the first time I've been back in person in 3 years, 2 years, I don't know. But it's also nice to be talking to you about a topic that I'm really very fascinated about personally. And I have to thank the Memorial's archivist tonight, Jim Zobel. You know when you have an absolutely fantastic archivist and historian, when you ask them a simple question about something and they spend literally months and months, years of their lives, just finding these items and documents and putting them on your desk pretty regularly. So I definitely have to thank Jim for giving me a lot of this information that I'm going to share with you tonight. And again, he's found it bit by bit over the years. I also want to kind of acknowledge that there are some other people doing a lot of work in this area at the moment. One of them is a historian named Bob Seals, doing a lot of work, particularly on MacArthur and baseball. So I'm kind of standing on the shoulder of some very kind of very good historians here. Now, when people talk about General MacArthur, and they talk about what shaped him as a man and as a leader, they tend to talk about his mother and father. They tend to talk about his experience at West Point. They talk about his love for the Army. They talk about his great intellect, and they talk about his experience of World War I. These are all important, integral parts of what makes him the General MacArthur that we know so well. But I think there is one thing missing from that list, and that is athletics and his experience himself as an athlete, and then his lifelong love of athletics for basically his entire life. I think there's something about sport that colors how you assess others and their talent. I think it colors your perception of challenge. It changes how you view things like victory and defeat, and how you understand your opponent during the conflict and then after the conflict. This is certainly the case, I think, with General MacArthur, and I think he recognized this experience in himself, and then I think for most of his life he looked for it in others, or he tried to cultivate it in those around him. Again, this experience of being an athlete or being somebody in competition. His love of athletics permeates his whole entire story. And in his autobiography, he writes that really from kind of his earliest days, he had always loved athletics. He wrote that the spirit of competition moved me to participate in as many sports as possible. I became the quarterback on the 11, the shortstop on the 9, and the tennis champion of the campus. So again, obsessed with sports. As a teenager in 1893, MacArthur was sent to West Texas Military Academy. In his third year, he joined the football team, and he sat the bench that first year. But in his fourth and final year at the academy, he was the team's quarterback, and he was too slight to be imposing, but he impressed his teammates with his dogged determination to basically never give up and to get the job done. According to a former teammate, the scrimmages were hard on him, but he would get up and fight again. According to biographer William Manchester, what MacArthur achieved in sports as an athlete, he achieved by sheer stamina. Basically, he was not a born athlete, but he was a tenacious competitor. And if you've been an athlete, and perhaps a very skilled athlete, and you have encountered an opposing player who is not as good at you, but just won't give up, you know how annoying a player like that can be. And so I think that was MacArthur in a nutshell. You might be better than him, but he was never, ever going to give up. His final year at West Texas was probably the high point of his athletic achievement in some ways. He was a quarterback again of that team, and he leads the team to an undefeated, unscored upon season. Some of the historians that write about this will say, well, there wasn't a lot of competition there, but I don't think that matters. I think the point is he has this victorious season, and he's kind of the leader of this effort. Now, that season marks the end of his career as an actual football player, but it doesn't end his association with athletics. In fact, it ushers in almost six decades of continued devotion to this sport. In 1899, MacArthur enters the U.S. Military Academy at West Point, and he plays baseball in his sophomore and then junior year. According to Marty Maher, an Irish immigrant who worked at West Point for over 50 years in the Army Athletic Department there, MacArthur took considerable delight in the fact that a former West Point graduate, Abner Doubleday, class of 1842, was considered at that time the inventor of baseball. Now, baseball historians today do not agree with this claim, but the point is, even though the evidence is thin for us today, MacArthur, back as a young student at West Point, was thrilled that Army was the inventor, basically, of baseball. But back to Meher for a moment. He later wrote a book about his time in the athletic department at West Point, and he sent a signed copy of the book to MacArthur in about 1951. And we have a copy of that book in our archives. And he had Jim Thorpe sign it as well. So Jim Thorpe, as you're all probably pretty aware, was just an incredible athlete in the kind of the 20th century. He, like many other athletes of the day, was admired by General MacArthur and admired General MacArthur himself. So back to West Point, during his sophomore year, again, MacArthur played baseball. And in that sophomore year, he played in the first Army-Navy baseball game on May 18th, 1901. And it was an absolutely thrilling moment, I think, in his life. The team got to travel to Annapolis for the game, and the game was set for a start at 2:30. They got there about 15 minutes before it started to do a little bit of warm-up, and it was raining. And there are 3,000 people in the stands, or gathered around the field, so to speak, to watch this game. It's incredibly exciting, and every time MacArthur appears, he played left field, he was taunted by the crowd. So he comes up to battery, gets out into the outfield, they're taunting him. All the midshipmen have these songs that they sing about him, and the reason that they're focusing on him is not because he's the best player on the team, kind of far from it, but his father, Arthur MacArthur Jr., is military governor of the Philippines at the time, and he's in the newspapers a lot. And so the midshipmen decide that it's really funny to sing this little song that ends, "Are you the governor general or are you a hobo? Who is the boss of this show, you or Emilio Aguinaldo?" And so I don't know that that brings, you know, that people understand those today, but that would have been pretty funny, I think, back in 1901. So again, every time he appears, he's taunted. Now, in his autobiography, he says that he scored the winning run in the game. And unfortunately, that is not exactly what happened, but that, I think, is probably how he remembered it. So he scored a key run in the third inning, but again, not the winning run. The home team batted first in those days, and Navy was winning 1-0 at the top of the third, and then Army comes up with three runs in the bottom of the third. And MacArthur is going to be one of those runs. And basically what happened is the Navy pitcher that year was just a wild one. I mean, he was hitting people left and right, walking a lot of people, throwing a lot of wild pitches. And so one of those, you know, he hits two players at bat before MacArthur. They both get on base. And then he walks MacArthur. Bases are loaded. There's a couple errors committed by the Navy team, and you get those three runs in. And so MacArthur is one of those runs. Now, the Army gets one more run after that. They win the game 4-3. So it's not MacArthur winning the game, but he does score a very important run as part of the game. Regardless of who really gets that winning run, MacArthur considers it, again, one of the most thrilling days of his whole entire life. He never forgets it, neither do his teammates. And Jim found this telegram in our archives about a year ago, and this was sent to MacArthur in May of 1951. This is about a month after he's been fired by President Truman. And it's from a former teammate and West Point cadet, Stephen Abbott. And Abbott sends him this note and basically says, "You know what, 50 years ago we played in basically this fantastic baseball game. We won, and you have been on the winning team ever since." So I just find that really amazing. 50 years after the fact, this game still means so much to these athletes. And this is a wonderful way for Abbott to really encourage MacArthur, I think, at a very kind of dark moment in terms of his career. So I told you earlier that MacArthur played his junior year as well. Basically, he sits the bench that year. And that's just because there are a lot of better players at that point on the team. We had a virtual event a while back where we talked in a live event on Facebook about MacArthur and baseball. And I asked Jim Zobel point blank, was MacArthur any good? And I think the answer is that he's a daring player. He's a smart player. He can get on base because of those qualities a lot of the time, but he's not an elite college athlete. He wasn't back then, and he certainly wouldn't be today. And when you look at all the box scores and all of the, you know, all the stats that you can find on these games, he has the worst fielding percentage of the team. And that, I think some historians think, might be a typo because it's so bad. And they think he probably couldn't have been that bad and played for Army even at that time. But it's clear he wasn't the best at that. He's also batting 266 when everyone else on the team was about 310 to 320. So not terrible, but again, not the best. He's a smart player. He's not a superstar. And he uses those smarts and he uses his kind of, you know, tenacity to be the athlete that he needs to be at times. MacArthur letters in baseball at West Point, and he's incredibly proud of that, really for the rest of his life. And in fact, this is the last photograph that we have that was taken of MacArthur. He's sitting at Walter Reed, he's sitting with President Johnson, and he's wearing his West Point bathrobe with that baseball letter on it. And he's going to be incredibly proud of this letter his entire life. So he plays baseball at West Point, he letters in it, and as his biographer D. Clayton James points out, at 5'11 and about 130 pounds, he wisely did not try out for football at West Point. In fact, deaths did occur in football, especially in those kind of early years. After his time at West Point, a football player was killed in a Harvard Army game, and the Army Navy game was actually suspended for a while between 1894 and 1898 because both services thought that it was they needed to discontinue such a violent contest between the two academies. In the first Army-Navy game alone in 1890, one of the players was knocked out three different times in the same game. And I mean, there's no concussion protocol back then, so you just kind of keep going. And this young man is knocked out three times. So it's a very violent sport. They also don't have the same level of protective equipment that athletes have now, and even now, it's very dangerous. So this it's, again, very smart that MacArthur did not probably play. So despite the dangers, though, many of the players that are on the team while he's at West Point are All-Americans. These are some of the best football players in America at this point. You've got Pot Graves, Charles Daly, Paul Bunker, and Charles Farnsworth. And these are all young men that MacArthur knows very, very well. And he's incredibly proud that his friends are these All-Americans. While MacArthur doesn't play, he does get as close to the team as possible. And in his final year at West Point, when he's first captain, when he has an incredible academic average, when he's clearly working hard in so many other areas, he serves as team manager of the football team. And this is for the 1902 season under Coach Dennis Nolan. And at this time, Army played most of their games on the plain at West Point, overlooking the Hudson. So they don't have that great stadium at this point. MacArthur, I think, during this time also learned some valuable lessons about being behind the scenes of a victory, maybe not being the person at the forefront. And he learns how you support the team to achieve the victory. And in that year, in the Army-Navy game, Army wins 22-8. And he is absolutely thrilled by that. And he feels very much a part of that, even though, again, his role is as kind of a team manager, not necessarily one of the athletes. Now, in 2008, Sports Illustrated tried to figure out who would have won the Heisman Trophy that year in American football if that award had been offered at that time. And one of the people that MacArthur knew, Bunker, he is chosen as the recipient of the Heisman Award for that year, 1902. And he and MacArthur, again, they're friends, they're classmates, they will serve together as future officers, and his career will really, in many ways, be entwined with MacArthur's. Flash forward several decades, following Japanese military offensives throughout the Pacific and in the Philippines, President Roosevelt orders MacArthur to leave the Philippines and go to Australia. MacArthur very reluctantly leaves. He promises very quickly to return, but his last memory of leaving the Philippines, at least according to his autobiography, is of Bunker. At that time, his old classmate, who's now a colonel, and is one of these men on Corregidor. And MacArthur writes in his autobiography that through the shattered ruins, my eyes saw topside. And that's kind of the top of Corregidor, this fortress. And he says, there was a deep roar of heavy guns there growling in defiance with their red blast tearing the growing darkness asunder. Up there, in command, was my classmate, Paul Bunker. 40 years had passed since Bunker had twice been selected for All-American teams. I could shut my eyes and see his blonde head racing, tearing, plunging, 210 pounds of irresistible power. I could almost hear the quarterback's shrill voice barking, "Bunker, back." He and many others up there were old, old friends bound by the ties of deepest friendship. Bunker would go into captivity with all the other troops on Corregidor on May 6, 1942, when it was surrendered to Japanese forces. And he happens to be the officer that General Jonathan Wainwright instructs to take the American flag down, kind of raise a white flag in surrender, and then destroy the American flag so that it can't be a war trophy for the Japanese. Bunker destroys most of it, but he saves a little strip of the flag. He goes into captivity, again, with all of the other the troops on Corregidor, and he dies in the absolutely hellish Bilibid prison. But before he dies, he makes sure that one of the men that he hopes survives him has a piece of that American flag, and he instructs this man to give it to the Secretary of War someday when liberation occurs. This little flag fragment is now in the West Point Museum, and it's an incredibly amazing artifact of that war. But I think that football connection between Bunker and MacArthur is also very important. This is the kind of man that these sports and these academies are churning out in 1900. So MacArthur graduates from West Point in about 1903, and as we know, he goes on to become a very famous wartime leader. And I think this fame really eclipses his contributions to American sport. But again, it's these wartime experiences that really refine his vision of what athletics is and what its place in American society should be. He serves at the front in World War I and is very distressed to find that many of the officers that he is working with are not physically fit enough to fight in the early part of this war. And he develops a profound belief that athletics is the best training ground for those who are going to face the real world pressures of combat and command. And he feels like not only does it ensure the proper level of physical fitness required of the battlefield, but it helps you with decision making, it helps you with discipline, and it helps you have an ability to win or cope with disappointment, or to win or cope with, or to cope in some ways with loss. He's also convinced that it is a perfect way to instill kind of team values and to teach the individual how to kind of meld their talents to what the team is trying to accomplish. He's also convinced that officers need to learn how to coach, and that is perhaps the best way for them to improve their ability to communicate with their men, but also to learn to look out for the total welfare of the people they're responsible for. After World War I, he has the opportunity to put these beliefs into practice. He's appointed superintendent of West Point in 1919, and he arrives at a school that was known at that time as the Monastery on the Hudson. Not much had changed at West Point in many, many years, really since the Civil War. And so he immediately embarks on a series of reforms. Most of his reforms, while they eventually kind of take root, are not popular. The one that is athletics for the most part. And this reform, it makes athletics at West Point mandatory. So you used to go there and maybe you played a sport. During MacArthur's time there, athletics becomes a core part of your experience, whether you play at kind of the collegiate level or whether you play in the intramural system. Every cadet is an athlete in some way. And so that's something that MacArthur really pushes. 9 intramural sports are started at West Point during his tenure. And MacArthur appoints a young officer named Matthew Ridgway to be the director of this new kind of athletic program for intramural athletics. And there are lots of rivalries between the different cadet teams that participate, and cadets even start referring to intramural sports there as intra-murder sports because of the intensity of the competition. And MacArthur relishes this. He thinks that, you know, he definitely opposed hazing, you know, the kind of the brutality of that. He thought that that wasn't maybe the best way to create young officers. Instead, he found intramurder sports as the best way to do that, in a kind of an alternative crucible to make sure that these young officers were tough and also able to act as leaders and teammates. While he's at West Point, it's said that he composes this quatrain and has it carved above the school gymnasium doors. Upon the fields of friendly strife are sown the seeds that upon other fields on other days will bear the fruits of victory. And that is something that you'll see up at West Point today and a lot of other colleges and universities around the country. Now, I think had he not been a professional soldier, MacArthur might have become a coach. As superintendent, he lurked around all the practice fields, especially the football field. And the star of the team at that time was Red Blake. He was a third-team All-American. And in the first decades of college football, before teams fielded kind of distinct offense and defensive players, players tended to play everything. And so they called Blake an end. You know, he plays everything, both offense and defense, and he's simply an end. Blake was one of the best ends of his time, and MacArthur took a lot of interest in his career, and in the decades to come, both of these men would correspond frequently, because Blake is going to be the future coach of Army football. So they're going to have a very, very close relationship in the future. 1919, MacArthur sends John J. Pershing tickets to the Army-Navy game, and he writes them a long letter, but he basically tells them that Army will turn out a well-rounded team, the line is excellent, the end's good, and the back's fair, with a superb fighting spirit. It will not be a great team, but it will take a great team to beat it. And during MacArthur's tenure, sadly, Army never beat Navy. Despite this disappointing record, though, he does lay the groundwork for future teams and is absolutely instrumental in recruiting some of the players that will be there for the 1922 season when Army does beat Navy. Unfortunately, MacArthur's just not there anymore. One of the players that he recruits is a player named Ed Garbish, and Garbish was appointed to West Point. He plays on that 1922 team right after MacArthur leaves. And he goes on to be an All-American standout, and he helps lead that 1922 team to a victorious season. And incidentally, he marries Bernice Chrysler, daughter of Walter P. Chrysler. And in 1930, they marry in 1930, and they are also art collectors. And so if you ever go to the Chrysler Museum today, many of the primitive American art that they collected is in the Chrysler's collection. So there's a MacArthur Chrysler art connection as well, and football connection. MacArthur's also very involved with baseball at West Point while he's superintendent. So he's at those practices as well. And the coach of the baseball team at that time was Hans Lobert, a former Major League Baseball player. He'd played for the Pirates, the Cubs, the Reds, the Phillies, the New York Giants. He was an absolute legend, and he was known for his speed and for stealing bases. And every Monday morning during baseball season, he had a standing meeting with MacArthur. First thing MacArthur did every week, he had to know about baseball around the country, but particularly West Point baseball as well. And so they would have these strategy meetings about the baseball games. Red Blake, the football player, also plays baseball. And he recalls Superintendent MacArthur coming to the baseball practices. And one day when Blake was having trouble batting, and traditionally around this time, Army batting was very difficult. You know, they just always had problems with this. MacArthur, when he was superintendent, would try to have major league players come in their off season to try to give all of the cadets pointers. They could never really work this out, at least back then. And so one day Blake is having trouble hitting the ball. And MacArthur comes over to him, he takes his jacket off, he takes his uniform off, and he says, well, let me give you a few pointers. Let me show you how to hit it. And Blake said that MacArthur couldn't hit a thing. And then he said he himself was messed up for a week after listening to MacArthur's advice. It was so wrong in some ways and it didn't work. And he said it took him a week to come out of that. and get back to hitting at least an average. And so he said also, though, that it was the only time he ever saw General MacArthur really fail. So as superintendent, MacArthur was often invited to the Polo Grounds to watch baseball. And there are rumors in some books about him that he was palling around with Ty Cobb around this time period. And we don't really think so. We've not found evidence of that. In the 1950s, MacArthur does make some comments. I think he even writes something saying that Ty Cobb is one of the greatest ball players ever and that he really admires his kind of offensive, the way he plays. And Cobb finds out about this. And he writes a letter to MacArthur that we found in the archives, but he writes it in a way that's almost like they've never met. So again, we don't think that in the 20s he was hanging out with Ty Cobb. He was probably aware of him, he probably admired him, but they don't really know each other and begin to have a relationship until the 1950s. And Ty Cobb writes this letter to MacArthur saying, you know, thank you so much for recognizing me and saying that I'm this great athlete. By the way, I think you're amazing. And so obviously with that lovely letter, again, they do kind of have a friendship. And we have at least one, I think we may have more, baseballs in our collection given to MacArthur that were signed by Ty Cobb. So an interesting part of our collection for sure. Now, after MacArthur's departure from West Point in 1922, wherever he's stationed around the world, he's always firing off messages about West Point athletics. He always wants to know what's going on. He always wants to know who's being recruited. And he is even trying to influence different congressmen about their appointments to West Point because he wants to make sure that the best athletes are going to West Point. The U.S. Olympic team will also benefit from his interest in sport. And because of everything he'd done in terms of kind of collegiate athletics, intramural athletics, he has really risen by the 1920s and 30s in prominence in terms of athletics in America. People have a lot of respect for him, the systems he's developed. And so when the U.S. Olympic Committee president dies shortly before the 1928 Olympics, they need a new president. And they, of course, reach out to MacArthur, who's a major general at the time. And he has to seek permission from the Army Chief of Staff to do this. That man, Charles P. Summerall, is a sports enthusiast himself, and somebody who I think likes MacArthur quite a bit. And he's very willing to allow MacArthur to serve on detached duty for the duration of the Olympics. He's very familiar with MacArthur's theatricality, with his ability to charm, and I think he hopes that MacArthur's involvement in the Olympics on this national stage will result in very good publicity for the Army. And with Summerall's approval, MacArthur enthusiastically accepts the job. And as Summerall hoped, American participation in the 1928 Olympics, according to MacArthur biographer William Manchester, is a MacArthur production. MacArthur quickly solves a crisis that was looming between the NCAA and the American Athletic Union that would have jeopardized the participation of our athletes in that Olympics. He gets them to kind of resolve their issues quickly. Then the U.S. Olympic delegation gets on board the SS Roosevelt. They go to Amsterdam, and for the duration of the games, MacArthur is there with the team. I think he was supposed to be a little bit more of a figurehead. He decides that he is the official coach of literally every single sport and every athlete that's there with him. Now, he is there with pre-Tarzan, Johnny Weissmuller. He is there with 13-year-old diving sensation, Dorothy Poynton. And as it happened, I think, in World War I and the men under his command at that time, Team USA quickly becomes not just his responsibility, but another family for him. And I think the team really returns this affection. If you go into our archives, you'll see basically from the 1940s onward, when MacArthur is involved in World War II and the Korean War, a lot of members of this Olympic delegation are writing letters to him saying how much they appreciated what he did for them back in the Olympics and really wishing him well in the fight that he's undertaking at the moment. As the leader of Team USA, he actually leads them in the Parade of Nations that opens the games. The man carrying the flag is Johnny Weissmuller. He's covered up, can't see his face. MacArthur is the person directly behind him, walking Team USA into the stadium. The games are not without drama. There's controversy during the women's swimming competition when Hilda Schrader, a German champion swimmer, has her bathing suit straps break and she can't exit the pool because she can't do it decently. And she's forced to remain in the water for a while until they can figure out a solution to get her out of the pool. And in the stands, in full view of the press corps, MacArthur's one of these very famous people there, all the newspaper reporters are watching him to see what he'll do, and apparently he made a very dramatic show of averting his eyes so that he would not witness this moment. It's a very exciting event for the press corps. It's like one of the big headlines of the day for women's sports. But this press is, they're looking at women as kind of objects of fascination at this Olympics, not really as athletes. But what I think is interesting is that as the leader of Team USA, MacArthur looks at Team USA through one lens. Male or female, they are America's best, and he devotes his days to their success. No competition, no athlete is insignificant to him. He wants to win it all. And during the competition, I said he also kind of coaches many of the athletes, even if it's not his job, and even if it's not very welcome. When the U.S. boxing team threatens to withdraw from their events because they think the judging is unfair, he basically tells them Americans never quit. You know, too bad. The team decides not to withdraw after he puts a lot of pressure on them, and they eventually, at least four of them, make it to the quarterfinals of their competition. MacArthur is a sensation at these Olympics, whether he is with different royals that are there to present awards or to watch their nations compete, whether he's with sports writers, whether he's with Americans, foreigners, commoners, whoever it is, he's an absolute sensation. And his biographers say this is because his enthusiasm for the games really endeared him to everyone that was there. I think they were expecting a very serious, boring general. And instead what they get is somebody who is, you know, in the 10,000 meter race, when the victorious athlete really just zooms by some of his competition. It's such an amazing race, such an amazing feat. MacArthur jumps out of the box. You know, he's in a nice box watching this with the other VIPs. He jumps out and he runs onto this field to be there when the athlete crosses the finish line. You know, this is not something people are expecting a major general to do, but he's that excited about it. When the U.S. rowing team is competing, MacArthur has his chauffeur, at great peril, drive along the banks of the river they're rowing in so that he can keep pace with them and yell at them, you know, if he needs to tell them to kind of hurry it up. So he cheers them along. In every competition, he is experiencing the thrill of competition with them and really the agony of defeat at times. And when some U.S. athletes don't do as well as the press expected them to do, he calls a team meeting and he tells them, you represent the greatest nation on the face of the earth. We are here to win. That's the only thing we're here to do. And we're here to win decisively. So he gives them a pep talk. He also holds regular meetings with all of the actual coaches and managers. And no one really enjoys these meetings. A sports writer at the time said that the meetings had the chilling temperature of a bank director's meeting. But in the end, they tended to produce good results. When the games close, August 12, 1928, the United States finishes first in the medal count. This is an incredible achievement for any nation. And Team USA also holds 17 new Olympic records and 7 world records. So it's a very, very successful Olympics. In his after-action report to President Calvin Coolidge, MacArthur summed up his experience as president of the U.S. Olympic Committee in his most flowery prose. And I'm not going to read all of this to you because he quotes Plutarch, he quotes Themistocles, he talks about Achilles, he talks about Homer. It's a little overwrought, but I think the sentiment is very genuine. And he concludes his report to Coolidge with a sweeping statement about what sport means for America. He says, "Athletic America is a telling phrase. It suggests health and happiness. It arouses national pride and kindles anew the national spirit. In its fruition, it means more sturdy, more self-reliant, and a more self-helping people. It means, therefore, a firmer foundation for our free institutions and a steadier, more determined hold on the future. Nothing is more synonymous of our national success than is our national success in athletics. Now, President Coolidge does not know what to make of MacArthur's very, very lengthy report. He finds it perplexing, he finds it a little dramatic, but MacArthur's sentiments are appreciated by many across the country. His quote about America and athletics is later engraved on a panel in the Douglas MacArthur Room in the U.S. Olympic House in New York City. And years later, as U.S. Army Chief of Staff during the Great Depression, he would again come back to this position and encourage athletics as something to generate national confidence, national hope, and national morale. Flash forward to World War II. 1942, this is a very difficult year for MacArthur and for many around the world. MacArthur meets with Colonel Russell Reeder at his headquarters in Brisbane, and he tells Reeder that when he's feeling the pressure of command, when he's feeling at this point in 1942 that so many things are going wrong, that he's able to sleep at night because he recalls his days as a baseball player or his time when he's superintendent and all those days he spent on with the baseball team. And he says that he's looking forward to a time when he can go back to America and go to a baseball game again. And that's something that's kind of getting him through some of these difficult days. He wants to sit in one of these stadiums, he says, with a hot dog and a bottle of soda pop in my hands and yell at the umpire. And I can't imagine General MacArthur that I know yelling at an umpire, but apparently that was on his wish list during the war. Unfortunately for him, it would be many years before he would be able to attend these games back in the States again. In his autobiography, General MacArthur also sums up his World War II island hopping strategy with a quote from baseball legend Willie Keeler. "Hit 'em where they ain't." Now, Keeler has the highest career at bats per strikeout ratio in Major League Baseball, in history, basically, of that. And he was notoriously hard to strike out. He frustrated a lot of the teams that he played against with his ability to send baseballs wherever they were not. And so that was frustrating for them. And MacArthur views island hopping as very similar to this. And as historian Bob Seals points out, MacArthur sees baseball as a creative intellectual framework, really for all of life. And in this case, it has military applications. So baseball for MacArthur is business and pleasure. Now, during the war, MacArthur is keeping in touch with the coach of West Point's football team. And he, during the war, fires off this telegram to the coach, who's by this time Red Blake. Now, MacArthur's absolutely ecstatic because it's 1944, Army has defeated Navy for the first time in a very, very long time. And he sends this telegram, basically, "The greatest of all Army teams, we have stopped the war to celebrate your magnificent success." This is hyperbole at its finest, but I think you can't doubt his enthusiasm for this win. And I think this is one of these telegrams that really kind of gives you a window into the things that he did care about very, very much. Now, during the occupation of Japan, MacArthur again turns to sport as an invaluable tool. He was very aware of the cultural importance of baseball for both the U.S. and Japan, and he worked very hard to create an environment in Japan that allowed baseball to be this diplomatic force that could bridge the gap between the former enemies. He invites Lefty O'Doul, a former major league star and manager of the minor league San Francisco Seals, to Japan to set up a massive goodwill tour there to really help bring back Japanese baseball, but also give the American troops there on occupation duty and the Japanese citizens something they can come to together in a very positive way. And in the 1930s, O'Doul had actually cultivated a young talent by the name of Joe DiMaggio. So he knew Joe DiMaggio pretty well, but he had also been the architect of a tour in the 1930s of Japan that had involved Babe Ruth and some of these other stars. So he was familiar with the country, and he's very willing to help MacArthur out with this project. Now, the tour that is set up is incredibly successful. You have about 500,000 fans come to see about 10 games across Japan. It's an amazing example of baseball diplomacy. And I want to emphasize, though, that, you know, baseball doesn't come to Japan because of MacArthur. It had really already been there. But it's MacArthur, I think, with his love of sport. It's MacArthur with his personal connections and the respect of important athletes and teams around the United States that really makes this possible for Japan again. And I think there's a lot of historians that see MacArthur as very instrumental in the Japanese baseball programs that you see today. After MacArthur's dismissal in the Korean War, he's offered the job of Commissioner of Baseball, and he turns it down. We think he did that not because he didn't love baseball, but I think he was thinking he might end up in the White House. He's also got a lot of other things going on in that year, and so he turns it down. But even though he's not going to be Commissioner of Baseball, he is going to be able to attend a lot of major league games. For many years throughout his career, he had annual passes from both the American and the National Leagues that entitled him to some really amazing seats in any ballpark that he wanted to attend. And about 6 weeks after his firing, he takes his family to Ebbets Field, and via a microphone supplied by the Dodgers announcer, MacArthur tells the 25,000 fans that are there in attendance that, you know, he's been to the Polo Grounds, he's been to Yankee Stadium, and he was told, though, that if you really want to see baseball, you got to go to Brooklyn and you got to see the Dodgers play. And so he says, "I'm here to see real baseball." And the crowd just goes wild. It's probably one of the warmest welcomes he ever gets in a stadium like this. He'll go to a number of other games, and this is a photograph from one of those other games that he attends. He's going to meet Roy Campanella, Jackie Robinson, number of other great players, and a lot of these players and even some former players that are going to be at some of these games are going to give him signed baseballs. They're going to give his son, Arthur, signed baseballs. And so in our collection, you know, we have signed baseballs from Babe Ruth, Ty Cobb, Tris Speaker, Ted Williams, anybody that you can think of who played baseball from the 1920s to early 1950s, we've probably got their name on a baseball here, and we're still finding some every now and then. MacArthur also continues to correspond with Rhett Blake about the Army team. In 1951, there is a cheating scandal that rocks West Point. They end up having to expel 37 cadets who were football players. It absolutely guts the football program there. There are calls for Rhett Blake to resign. MacArthur tells him, "Don't do it, stay on." And Rhett Blake stays on in this role. MacArthur's support for him will be instrumental in basically Blake staying on and in the really difficult rebuilding seasons that follow. There's about two seasons after this cheating scandal where Army football, again, it's gutted, they're not very good, and any coach knows that it is very hard to have losing season, and I'm not just talking regular losing season, I mean terrible season after terrible season and still keep your job. But MacArthur's support, I think, is one of the factors that keeps Blake there. Now, 1953, a rebuilt Army team after those two devastating years has a winning season, and they even win against Navy. So in MacArthur's mind, that whole season is a win. MacArthur's faith in Blake is incredibly well-founded. In his career, Blake would coach three Heisman Trophy winners and 11 Hall of Fame players. But his dynasty doesn't really end there. 20 of his assistant coaches would go on to become head coaches, including Vince Lombardi. Lombardi would later credit Blake's decision to stay as head coach and MacArthur's encouragement of him to do that as the best example he ever had of perseverance in a leadership position. And he would take MacArthur's "no substitute for victory" maxim to heart. MacArthur wasn't quite finished yet. Towards the end of his life, his country would call on him yet again to use his passion for sport and his status as a veteran statesman to save American sport from international crisis. At the request of President John F. Kennedy, at the age of 82, MacArthur was asked to solve another dispute between the NCAA and another athletic union. This was going to derail American participation in the Tokyo Olympics of 1964. And Kennedy was not willing to accept that, but there was no one that these other sports organizations would listen to but MacArthur. They agree to his mediation. He comes up with a solution. They accept the solution, and suddenly America will have a Team USA to send to this Olympics. According to Kennedy, MacArthur's participation in this process made American participation in the 1964 Tokyo Olympics possible, at a time in American history when a victory in the Olympics meant a victory in the Cold War. Unfortunately, neither men, while they both realized that they were kind of responsible for putting this team there in the future in 1964, unfortunately, neither one of them would live to actually see that Olympic game. MacArthur's legacy to American sport continues today. Every year since 1959, the National Football Foundation has awarded the MacArthur Trophy to the best NCAA Division I college football team. It's a 400-ounce silver trophy designed by Tiffany's, and it was a gift of an anonymous donor in honor of General MacArthur. And it's kind of like the Stanley Cup. It's one of a kind. It's kept by the winner for a year, and then it goes back and goes to the next winner. And MacArthur's famous quote, "There is no substitute for victory," is engraved on the trophy. In addition, starting around 1965, the Norfolk Sports Club of Norfolk, Virginia has presented a General Douglas MacArthur Award to a graduate of a Virginia high school who's recognized as an outstanding athlete in a college or university program. Now, MacArthur is mostly remembered as a military leader, and I think few people remember his contributions to American sport and even to Japanese sport. But his interest in athletics was both personal and professional. He was a competitor at heart, and he simply, I think, loved athletics, but he also found it one of the greatest outlets and kind of accomplishments of mankind. As a professional soldier, he recognized the practical benefits of athletics on leadership and citizenship. And I think, again, just personally, he saw it as one of the greatest things that we do that we're not killing each other doing. In 1959, when the National Football Foundation presented MacArthur with its gold medal award for his contributions to college football, MacArthur remarked, "Many even believe in these cynical days of doubt and indecision that through this sport we can best keep alive the spirit of reality and enterprise, which has made us great. In all my own long public service, both in war and peace, it is the football men that I have found my greatest reliance." Now, he says football in this speech, but as he demonstrates, I think, throughout his career, whatever the sport, athletes and coaches were people that he greatly admired. And sport and its moments of excellence, whether of individual or of team achievement, these, I think, he found as reasons for hope, even in the most turbulent of times. And I think he saw sport, and especially sport in America, as something incredibly important for our past, for our present, and for our future.